Hey y'all, welcome back to Interstage Window, my Saturday stream, which is with my friends. And today I have with me Landon. Say hi, Landon.
Hi, Landon.
Oh my gosh, and welcome in, Kendra.
I
You made it, freaking. We'll tell y'all why we're starting late in just a second. I want to first say welcome in, Kendra. Welcome in, Koneko. I'm gonna go lurk for a bit first. Oh, thank you so much for the lurk, Koneko. We love that. Kendra, you've got to come back with kitty cat pictures. I understand you're getting a kitty
Yes.
today.
I
So
was just
I
about to type
definitely,
kitten update. I need one.
yes. Oh my God, I need to see the kitten update as soon
All
as you
the
have it, Kendra. Very
kittens.
important. All right, you guys. So with that, yes, we are starting 50 minutes late today. So before we actually get into the
Whoopsies.
topic, my God, Landon, what happened? Are you okay?
I'm fine. I left my uncle's house 2 hours ago at the, or almost 2.5 hours ago at this point. It's 30 minutes away. But what I first ran into in very small New England town fashion was that they had closed the only intersection in the entire town down for a bike race. So I then had to pull a quick U-ey, go 20 minutes out of my way to get onto the highway where I was in dead stop traffic for about 40 minutes.
Yep. So what should have taken half an hour turned into 2 hours, right?
2 hours. Yeah, 2 hours. And I was texting Karen the whole time being like, hey, I know we start for 40 minutes, but I've been stopped here for a while. So who knows when I'll make it.
I got that text at like 11:15. Yes, absolutely appropriate sound effect, Kendra. 100% correct. Yeah, I got the text at like 11:15 and I was like,
She's like,
well,
why? I had to preface it. I was like, listen, I'm just dead stopped and I'm still 30 minutes away. So tell me what's up.
and you were like, your GPS says it's going to be another hour, even though you know it should be 30 minutes. So it was like, we
Yes.
don't know when. So I was like, you know what? Let's just start when we start. We'll end when we end. We'll play it loosey goosey today.
Yes.
So yeah. So with that being said, Landon, what are we talking about today?
We are talking about the one thing that will make my day better. From the stressful morning, which is, let's talk about ships, baby. We're talking about them Harry Potter ships and the shipping wars that was ensued because of them. So
Yes.
truly get to discuss some of our favorite pairings from the Harry Potter series, as problematic and questionable as they may be. People are still obsessed with them, so we'll
Great.
talk about them today.
Yes, we will. Yes, we will. And y'all that are listening, please let me know if the audio sounds okay. Love to hear about that. And then also, before we get started, just a few disclaimers. This, of course, is not spoiler-free. I don't know why you would click on a video called Harry Potter Ships and not expect spoilers. There's going to be spoilers all over the place for the entire Wizarding World. We are not a spoiler-free podcast in general. Also, we do not approve of or condone what J.K. Rowling is doing on the Twitters and with her money and political power. Okay, fuck TERFs. Can I get a fuck
Fuck
TERFs?
turfs.
That's right.
Fuck turfs.
So
That needs to be a sound, by the way. Maybe I'll spend my little bits to have you make a fuck turf sound. That could be fun.
well, there's got to be lots of people saying it, so we'll have to pick out a fun
I
one.
have I have some I have some Dimension 21s that say it.
Ooh,
So
okay.
I will show you a clip. But anyway.
Yes. Okay, I like it. We need that, I think. It would be appropriate. So yes. So fuck TERFs, we don't approve of that. This is too the both of us, we have been in the Harry Potter fandom since we were children, and it is what it is. We've got over 24 hours of Harry Potter content if you are curious about any of that. I'm sure you can find lots of videos where we're talking about it, particularly ones where we focus on Slytherin, or we do have one that focuses on J.K. Rowling herself. So yeah.
Yes.
So that being said, let's get into it. Here we go. Let's go. Harry Potter ships. Let's talk about ships, baby. Let's talk about fandom and shipping
Yes. Which
wars.
is a huge part of the development of fandom. Like, I think maybe that's a good thing to preface with before we actually start going to talk about the individual ships, is that there have always been shipping wars, but the Harry Potter fandom, because it kind of existed in the rise of the internet, kind of took over there for a hot minute. Certainly didn't have the biggest wars, but it had some decently down and dirty doxing wars because of who you liked as fictional characters paired together, which looking back is a really dark time for the internet, I feel.
Yes, I mean, massive shipping wars were happening over Harry Potter, and social media wasn't even a thing yet. There was all kinds of drama, and a lot of it did have shipping at its core, even if the drama was actually about something else. You know, if you think of like the Misscribe drama, for example, you know, which websites you chose to post your fics on had a lot to do with which ships you were aligned with and what type of a fandom you were interested in being in. And that was kind of an instigation of a lot of drama and wars between the different fan sites, because there was no AO3 at the time. Okay, there was no AO3. Yeah. There was fanfiction.net, but it was a very different world. So actually there was like 6 or 7 different websites that you would go to find Harry Potter fiction. And depending on what ships you were looking for, largely dictated what sites you frequented. Like, that was very common.
Yeah, no, there was like, I remember particularly, actually not on our list, surprisingly, but was a Hinny website that I used to go to. Prior to shipping Draco and Harry, I shipped Ginny and Harry. And there was like an entire website dedicated to it. And that's the only thing that was allowed. You could have secondary pairings like Ron and Hermione and stuff like that. But for the most part, you were only allowed to post Hinny forward stories.
Yep.
And anything else but that, you were booted off. And there was a lot of competition between these websites. So there was a lot of like, oh my gosh, guys, there's another website that does Harry and Hermione fan fiction. So what we really need to do is we need to post more Hinny stuff so that we can beat out their Harry and Hermione, so that you can show that we have more followers. It was school ground tactics.
It was. Oh my God. And it makes me think of like today because like a Discord server, I think, is very similar the way that they function today. So it's kind of like all of these websites behaved as this like network of rival Discord servers. If you can imagine like something like that, if you've ever been involved in Discord server drama, you know exactly what I'm talking about, but that's what it was like. That is what it was like.
And it was even like Google had obviously existed at that point in time, but it was really hard to find some of these websites too. I will of course never complain, because I am of the generation where I could get fan fiction online instead of having to like attend cons to switch up fan fiction. But it certainly was like you had a link, have a link from a friend of a friend, and maybe you find the couple that you like, and maybe that would be where you could post. And once you found a good one, you kind of stuck there.
Yes. Oh my God. Hey, Rar. Oh my gosh. It's been a second since I've seen you on one of the Saturday streams, I feel. Or maybe you were in one recently. I don't remember. But it feels like it's been a second since I've seen you. Hi.
I feel like Rar was here a couple weeks ago.
I feel like that too. But it feels like also forever ago. Because I finally got a moving date, like all of my time is like all jacked up. Oh, Half-Blood Prince. Yes. Maybe that's why. Maybe because it's been a while since we've had a Harry Potter stream and you tend to come to those. I think that's why I feel like it's been a minute. But welcome back. We're talking about ships today. So do we want to get started on the first ship that we'd like to talk about?
Yes. Let's talk about one of the most stable yet controversial ships. I feel like for some reason media has decided to make this one controversial, probably because JKR herself, and that would be Hermione.
My God. Okay. The absolute fucking shit show of shipping wars over
so
Hermione versus like Harry and Hermione was like blew my mind. Because okay, like before the movies, there was no Harry and Hermione. That was not a ship. That was like a crack ship, it was both a crack ship and a rare pair in the community before the movies. When the movies came out, the truth was between the actors, and because they did a lot where they removed certain things from Ron's character and then gave Hermione's character a little bit more, because like, let's be honest, in the books, she's like an annoying little bitch. Okay.
Yeah.
So they kind of did a little bit of fix it in the movies to make Hermione a little bit cooler. And that ended up being a detriment to Ron's character, because they got to make sure the trio, everyone's still different. Right. So in the movies, there's a decent amount of Harry and Hermione content that you could draw from for shipping purposes. And once those movies started coming out, and people saw that, and they saw the better writing and better chemistry between Harry and Hermione than they did between Ron and Hermione, it was absolute, like, it was an explosion. And people, like, well, legit would fight over which was going to be the end game.
Which is crazy, because it felt very on the wall that it was always going to be Ron and Hermione. But, like, specifically, like, just to prove this point, as far as this is a movie ship and not a book ship, Harry and Hermione don't have any alone time together until the fourth book. And then again, they don't have, they barely have any alone time together until the seventh. For the most part, Ron is always there. There isn't really much interaction of them one-on-one. The only time there is when Ron isn't speaking to Harry.
And I think, like, that, basically, yeah. But I think a big part of this is because in the movies, you don't get Harry's internal dialogue, which if you go back and read the books, he is really mean in regards to Hermione. Like, he is, like, so over her know-it-all attitude. He doesn't really have any sympathy for her and what she goes through being an intelligent woman who's confident. Like, his internal monologue about her is downright cruel. So it is very hard as somebody like me who started on the books to see Harry and Hermione as a possibility, because I know what Harry really thinks about Hermione, and it's not nice. Not that Hermione's not nice herself and doesn't maybe deserve some of his criticism, but, like, I can't see them as a couple. I can't.
Well, like, that's the thing. Like, that is the point of her, right? The point of Hermione was to be that annoying, know-it-all 11-year-old. It just, unfortunately, because of optics of fandom, realized that there was no well-written main character women in the entire book. So all of a sudden, they had to make Hermione a fan favorite and had to change some of her personalities within the movie, because they needed the majority of Harry Potter fans, which were young women, to feel represented. And so they did have to, like, change Hermione quite a bit. So she isn't as annoying. And because of that, we don't get to see also the right, like, Harry doesn't get to be mean to her because we don't have access to his internal monologue, but also there are less reasons for her and him to be mean.
Yes. And I think, like, if they had made a book accurate Hermione, we probably would have ended up with a similar situation of, like, what happened when they made the movie version of A Fault in Our Stars, right? And what's the name of the main dude in Fault in Our Stars? Remind me.
Gus.
Yes. So book Gus, you kind of think, like, oh, you know, you kind of understand him. He's quite charming because you're seeing him through the lens and the internal monologue of our main character, right? But if you actually look at, like, what he does in the book and how he acts and the things that he said, if you put exactly that Gus on screen, he's a fucking annoying jerk. But you know what they did? They put that Gus on screen, and all the fans were like, why'd you make Gus annoying? And it's like, Gus is annoying in the books. You just don't realize that because you're seeing it through the lens of someone who likes him.
Also, like, I don't know if they know this, but Hazel is also annoying. Like, that's the literal point of them, is that John Green wrote two annoying kids, both dying of cancer, who fell in love with each other.
Yeah, and I think though, if they had made book accurate Hermione on screen, like, fans would have had the same reaction. They would have been like, why'd you make Hermione extra annoying? Even if they made her exactly like the books, that the fandom would have said that.
Exactly. And they couldn't have, like, there was no opportunity for that because A, they knew that, but also because the majority of fans were young women who would have rebelled if they did not find a young woman they could put themselves into. So Hermione becomes kind of like that, like, pants sort of character in the books or in the movies. She's not as pantsy as, like, Bella Swan, but she certainly becomes something of a character that most women can try on, of, like, smart, there to clean up the mess, the mothering of the two boys. And because of that, and the natural chemistry that she and Dan Radcliffe had, a lot of people shipped themselves and Hermione with Harry.
You know what Lady is here for? She says, you know, I'm not going to hear about this slander. I ship Harry and Hermione, and y'all need to stop.
No. You deserve better.
You're a Harry and Hermione shipper, aren't you, Lady? Yes.
You deserve better.
Yes. The fans
which
were
is
young
what,
and they, yes.
Mm-hmm. Which is also, by the way, what we kind of got with Ron and Hermione.
Yeah.
I will sit here and say that I am biased. I'm a Hermione shipper through and through. I love a good happy ending. I love a good, I'm gonna pull her pigtails and she's gonna call me a stupid hag and we're gonna end up married sort of relationship. That is a trope of mine.
So unrealistic, but so cute. I support it.
Completely unrealistic, but yes. It's a book. We're not looking for realism. We're looking for that fiction.
Right. So like I was always on the Hermione train. You know, and I enjoyed Harry and Hermione in fic when it was a crack ship, but once people started taking it seriously, I lost interest. I'm not going to lie, you know. Yes. Oh, Kendra, let's put a pin in that. Let's put a pin in that little comment there, Kendra.
We couldn't do a shipping video without that one.
Yes. We're going to talk about it. Don't worry.
But I think the thing that is really like comfortable about Ron and Hermione is that it was kind of the cornerstone of romance throughout the entire book series. We saw characters in the sidelines getting together, but the Ron and Hermione relationship was very much a slow burn that I have a feeling JKR didn't intend, because there wasn't anything outwardly romantic happening until the sixth book.
Well, I think
and
also
then it was kind of like, oh,
yeah,
stumbled into that, huh?
It's tough because these kids are like 11 years old. So when you're reading the first few books, you have to remember that until J.K. Rowling got to book like three or four ish, she probably had no idea the massive hit she had on her hands. Not really, right? She didn't know that this train was just going to keep going and going and going. You know what I mean? So like she probably wasn't even thinking about like, what am I going to do with the romances? You know, I'll figure that out later, right? Because if you don't know if you're even going to make it all the way to the seventh book for sure, are you really going to plan that type of stuff? Like, probably not. These characters are absolutely kids.
No, and that's kind of why like romance always plays a second, like the Harry Potter books are not romance books.
No.
It always plays a second fiddle, even though there are romantic relationships that exist in them. But it is things like in the fifth book or the fourth book, Harry starts having a crush. And that's when we kind of start seeing like that 14-year-old boy sort of teenagedom of like, oh, girls exist. Maybe I should talk to them. And we don't really see Harry express feelings until the fifth book. And that's kind of when he clues in that the other people around him are also doing that too.
Yes, absolutely. And so then we get some internal monologue about it. I think it's totally possible that, you know, because the books are from Harry's perspective, that there was romantic interaction between Ron and Hermione in previous books that either Harry didn't notice or happened off camera. Like, I'm a big proponent of fics that have those sorts of things, because I think that fits very neatly into the canon that we have.
Which also, I will say, the movie shows really well. That's one thing that the movies had that the books necessarily didn't, is that they had these little moments between Ron and Hermione that showed this, whether it be like just like, oh, my favorite would be the Chamber of Secrets, where Hermione has just woken up at the end of the movie from being petrified. She comes running in, she runs and hugs Harry, and then there's just this awkward pause between Hermione and Ron that's just like, I don't want to hug you because I think I might like you, so let's shake hands.
It was so cute. It's so cute the way they do it in the movie. I love that part too.
My favorite thing about Harry being the narrator and also becoming an Auror later in life is that he never notices anything outside of his own life. So it's like, how are you going to become a cop if you don't notice the things that are happening and you can't put two things together without your sidekicks?
I don't even know. not like any cop I've ever interacted with, and they're usually too far the other direction. They're paying way too much attention to everyone else and like need to mind their own damn business. But I'm just saying.
Maybe that's what like Harry will do to even out the orders,
maybe,
I guess.
Maybe. So yeah. Hermione, the Harry Potter ship, I would say.
The Harry Potter ship. Truly fluffy, wonderful, full of jealousy, full of angst, slow burn build. Do we want to talk about them getting together and how awkward that is? Or do we want to save that for the seventh book stream?
I think we're going to definitely We're definitely going to talk about that during the seventh book. We're going to have to talk about that during the seventh book, cool. I definitely think. And in regard, but I do want to say in this episode, really quickly, I do not support what they did in Cursed Child, where they got divorced. Like, I know that's like super way more realistic, but just it's just another like element of Cursed Child where I'm just like,
well,
no, no.
It's also, I mean, that's okay. Yeah, let's definitely mention this as far as it's JKR's self inserting of Hermione once again.
Yeah.
And also rewriting narrative. Because she was fully support of Ron and Hermione. And then at some point, she just decided, hey, out of the blue, they actually get divorced.
Yeah.
And it's like, why do you need to add that? And then the purpose of the Cursed Child was because she got so much backlash on their divorce that she approved the fixing of it by having them get back together in Cursed Child and being like, no, Hermione, I've always loved you. And Hermione being like, I've always loved you too, Ronald. And it's like, okay, can we please stop the fan service?
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to have to figure out how to talk about Cursed Child in depth, but I did want to mention that in this episode.
You know what? We're going to do that. We're going to drink. We're going to take a shot and we're going to complain the entire 2 times of the 2 hours, the entire time.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Drunk because we have to talk about it.
We're going to have to. Okay. Next ship. Guess what? Now let's talk about Dramione. Okay. Y'all, the Dramione fandom is always impressive. They are always making the best art. They're always writing the hottest fic. They are always being like so ridiculously active, like Dramione's. I may
They're
not
so angry.
That's true. I may not be like totally on board with the ship as much as I am with Romani, but like, damn, I will look at some Dramione fan art. I will read some Dramione fic because y'all are doing so much, and I appreciate that. Every fandom should be as passionate as Dramione's.
See, here's the problem, is that when we start taking fandom into account and we start being able to create our UA, our AUs, and we're starting to be able to like take things further and explore characters, my Draco Malfoy is so incredibly gay that the idea of having Hermione just can't do it. So I can't read Dramione. For whatever reason, I can't. It is dreary, but in different font. But I can't do it.
It literally is. It's dreary with a different font. It's not different. It's het dreary. It's the same thing.
It's het dreary. And I'm like, man, I love my queer boys. Also, I love that Harry is an idiot and that Draco tells him that. Whereas in Hermione, Draco's the idiot and Hermione tells him that.
I think that's why I'm more into Hermione than I am into dreary, because I love the idea of I love idiot Draco. Like, that to me is so appealing because, like,
sure.
It's hard for me to be interested in his redemption arc if I don't commit to the idea that he's kind of a dumbass, you know?
Oh, yeah. He absolutely is a dumbass. Mm-hmm. But yes, no, it's the different dynamics. I appreciate Hermione. Obviously, trope-wise, we're talking enemies to lovers. We're talking redemption of an evil person. We're talking about flirtatious banter that never stops. There's a lot of tropes that are involved in the Hermione fandom that are classics, because when you have two people who grow up hating each other that all of a sudden end up together, there's a fun story to be told there.
Yes, there is. And I think that Hermione, like, my memory of it is Hermione barely existed again until the movies, just like Harry and Hermione was. Hermione, I feel like, happened because Emma Watson and Tom Felton just had this amazing chemistry due to Emma Watson's crush on him when they started filming. And yeah, she had a huge crush. It came through. He seemed like he was like okay with her having a crush, at least maybe not reciprocating it. But that type of chemistry is what you get in the movies, where like she has this amazing crush and he's like, I'll let you crush on me. It's cool. You can do that. Cool. I'm fine with it. And like that is like the starting point dynamic for Hermione that is so appealing, I think, and what makes me interested in it, even though in my versions of Harry Potter stuff that I like to write, I would typically not choose to write Hermione.
I wonder though. I do want to say that Hermione and Harry Hermione are slightly different. Yes, they both, I think, resulted of the movies, but I also feel like we can't count out necessarily the relationship between the two within the books, because simply for the fact that the movies started coming out when the third, fourth book was being written. So a lot of the things that like the Hermione, Draco's arc of his possible redemption, all of those things weren't taken into consideration when the birth of the movies started.
Yes.
So I think that that's a little bit nuanced there, that I don't necessarily think it's the entirety, the chemistry between the two actors, but I think that it probably would have been more popular than Harry and Hermione would have been if there had never been any movies.
Yes.
That's my theory, at least.
I totally agree, because I think like the idea of enemies to lovers is so ingrained in fandom, even if the actors didn't have chemistry, that fandom presence still would have been there. I just question whether Hermione would still be the type of ship that still gets new content regularly today.
He would not.
I don't think it would have been.
I don't think so. Although, like, here's the deal though. Like, Draco lovers, people who love Draco Malfoy, want redemption. And the easiest way to redeem a character is to show that they are loved and lovable, and to make them somebody who's worthy of love. So that I think that if there had still been a vehement, very powerful fandom behind Draco Malfoy, that also would have continued to push towards the possible romances that Draco could have made in connections. And to be completely honest, because Hermione is the only available woman of the main trio, I think there would have been a lot of people who are pushing that towards that direction too.
I totally agree, because the only other woman you ever really see Draco shipped with is Pansy, which is just stand-in, happens to have a name, Slytherin woman. You know, like, she doesn't really have much of a personality other than typical Slytherin.
And Luna Lovegood actually gets paired with Draco Malfoy quite a bit too. But even then, that's still, Luna Lovegood is a fan favorite, but is not of the main, like, Luna Lovegood doesn't generate her own fan fiction. Hermione, right. The character is going to generate her own fan fiction no matter what, because she is the main character woman. So it would have been, people I think would have been more drawn to that main character arc rather than a side character redeeming him. But that's just a theory. Hermione is fun. Their art does bang. Like, their art is awesome. I was looking for gifts for the slides and stuff like that, and there aren't any, because, you know, you don't see them very often, but there's so much art that I was just like, man, I wish we could have used art.
Yeah. And you know, if there's any artists in my community and you want us to be using your art for these, like, hit me up. But I just don't want to get into it. So this is why we never use fan art on these, even though we, like, legitimately could, because it is transformative. But I don't want anyone to ever feel like their art gets attached to something that they didn't, like, put their rubber stamp on and condone, because I know how that can make a lot of people feel. And I don't necessarily know if my opinions are going to be indicative of every artist that we use. And I just don't think I'm popular enough to propose it as, like, oh, I'll feature your art and then shout you out. Like, who's going to, you know, I'm not big enough for that, I don't think. So we just like to stick to official art, movie screenshots, GIFs, things like that, that are not going to be tied to a specific artist.
Yeah. So what that means is that you, viewer at home, have a homework assignment, and that is to Google Hermione fan art.
Yes, it's real good. It's real good.
It's,
my gosh.
It's worth it. It's real good. It comes in every flavor.
True.
All the flavors.
It really, really does. So yeah, Hermione, even if you don't like it, I think that there's appeal there, even if it's not your preferred Hermione ship or your preferred Draco ship. It's still real good.
Preferred Draco ship. And I feel like that's it. as far as Hermione gets mostly shipped with, we can, I mean, we don't have slides for them, but, you know, there's some fun Hermione, Ginny shippers. Hermione Pansy is actually an incredibly popular.
I've seen a lot of that. I've seen a lot of that. You know, there's not a lot of one. There's not a lot of ladies to pick from if you want to make a Hogwarts like lesbian ship. But the probably the biggest lesbian ship that I do see is Hermione and Pansy.
Hermione and Pansy and Lily, oh my God, and Luna and Ginny.
Yeah, Luna and Ginny.
Mm-hmm. Two typical.
Because Luna and Ginny are actually besties, so like that makes sense.
Yeah, they're in a throuple with Neville. It's fine.
Yeah, I think that's valid.
But no, I mean it's also very interesting. What I appreciate about Hermione shipping and the shipping wars is that it truly never really resulted in a love triangle. And this is obviously because JKR never went that direction. She teased it a little in the seventh book as far as Ron's jealousy towards it, but there was never really a push within the fandom of like, Hermione has to choose between these two. And even a lot of fics weren't like, Hermione must choose between Ron and Hermione or Ron and Harry. A lot of it was just like, here, this exists. And the same thing with like Dramini is in there too, where it's like Hermione just had a choice. She didn't have to choose between anybody. She just had a choice. And I appreciate that fandom kind of accepted that about the character.
Yeah, I don't ever remember it being similar at all to like Hunger Games or Twilight or anything like that. Nobody was talking about like, who's Hermione going to choose? They were literally just talking about like, what is going to happen in the end? It wasn't framed as like, who is Hermione going to choose? It was framed as what is going to end up being written in canon.
Yeah. And like not even written in canon, but like in fan fictions themselves, there's always going to be some where it's like, you know, Hermione having to choose. But for the most part, when fanfic artists and writers are choosing their fandom or their ship, they are not making her play both sides.
Yes.
And I think that that speaks to the character as well as the fandom around her. Because we do not see that in a lot of other fandoms in general, but also within our fandom.
Yeah, certainly
within
not.
The Harry Potter fandom. We'll talk about love triangles here in a second and being forced to choose.
Yes. Okay. So we go from the enemies to lovers into the gay. Okay, Landon, this is your time to shine. Let's talk about Dreary.
Listen, there is a line in the sixth book in which Harry Potter says, and in that moment, Harry Potter became obsessed with Draco Malfoy. And it just, that's all, right? it is that innate, I think because Harry as a character has always been obsessed with Draco Malfoy and always wants to know what Draco's doing. There is something so desperately queer about that, of just being like, oh, I'm obsessed with this boy and he has shiny hair and I just want to, you know, see what he's doing all the time and who he's hanging out with and who's paying for his lunch and blah, 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 blah. and it makes a lot of queer people happy. And I think that that's where it existed.
Yeah, well, there's the rivalry, you know, right? So like Draco and Harry are rivals, right? That is obvious.
Enemies to lovers.
Yeah, so you got the enemies to lovers. You know, it's the same reason that people ship a lot of the most popular queer anime ships, right? Because in anime, having your main character have a rival is very, very common, right? Whatever anime just sprung to mind to you, valid. That's exactly the one I was talking about. There's like so many, right? And Dreary is that. Now this type of thing, I feel like having a rival isn't quite as popular in a lot of YA that came after Harry Potter, but it remains very popular in anime. And therefore you have this gay ship, just like you have in basically every shonen anime that exists.
It also exists quite a bit in romance tropes and like romance novels tropes. And a part of me wonders if it is more generational than it necessarily is fandom based.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is like a huge, because as as the kids in the early 2000s were reading Harry Potter, they grew up, and now that fan base reads a lot of romance, whether it be like chick lit or actual like down and dirty romance, or just like things that are romance titled. A lot of the enemies to lovers is a huge trope that exists within the last 10 years in that media, or 15 years within that media. So I wonder if it's just kind of like, because we grew up from there, the Dramini grew up and wanted to see that, the Drarys grew up and wanted to see that sort of thing exist and continue. Just food for thought.
I do wonder if the whole like enemies to lovers has become less popular in for Zoomers. And I do think that it has a lot to do with the puritanical streak that we're seeing so much in fandom now. It's pretty common in ship wars nowadays to attack the other ship because they are enemies to lovers, and that is therefore toxic. Like, I've seen that in several more modern shipping wars, that the anti side is against the other side because the other side is an enemies to lovers ship, right? And that's what makes it toxic and bad, and you can't ship that. And our generation was just not like that. Like, millennials and older Zoomers, like, we didn't care. Like, we wanted the toxicity. We thought the toxicity was appealing. And I just feel like a lot of Zoomers today did not, oops, so sorry. Didn't mean to click that. A lot of Zoomers today just don't agree with that. They don't want the toxicity and in fact rebel against it. And so it's hard to imagine Drarry existing the way that it did. If it started now, it would be a very different situation.
Yes. And it's interesting because, like, to take on a generation as a whole and the philosophies behind it, they grew up in a generation watching the people before them be ripped to shreds in the media and public opinion and private opinion by the behaviors considered toxic by all of those things. Mm-hmm. So even like cancel culture being a thing, whether morally it's a good thing that we're calling out these people, they grew up seeing the effects of cancel culture while we are living it in time, having had an existence before it. So that really plays, I think, a whole lot into the psyche of, if what you are doing is bad, you're going to get called out for it. And therefore, I disagree with you. So what you must be doing is bad. Therefore, I'm going to call you out on it.
Yeah, and it makes this like crazy cycle. But yeah, I think go ahead. Sorry.
Go ahead. Oh, I was going to say, so yeah, that is the toxic cycle that exists that I think the fandom wars are really circling around. And what they haven't agreed with is that, frankly, everything could be considered toxic, especially book romances and ships, because that's what makes them exciting, unfortunately.
Books aren't real life, right? So what's
books
toxic?
Are not real life.
What's toxic in real life is quite different than what is, maybe not appropriate in fiction, right? Quite different, because they're not the same. But yeah, I think if Drarry, I think if Drarry was starting today, I think it would still be a wildly popular ship. Like, I don't think that you're going to ever pry enemies to lovers away from queer kids. I think that is always going to be popular. It is just incredibly appealing. But I think there would be quite a massive anti-Drarry population that I will say didn't really exist. Like, I don't remember too many people being anti-Drarry in the way that anties exist now. It was big not like a moralistic thing.
It was because it was queer.
Like, right, but it's not because, but people weren't like, oh, it's enemies to lovers. It was literally like, they were just straight up homophobic.
No,
they didn't pretend.
Yeah, it was not about enemies to lovers. It was about the, how dare you make Harry Potter gay? How
yes.
dare you make Draco Malfoy gay?
Yes.
It had nothing to do with the morality of that, but the morality of, like, what do you mean these two are together? They're not, they're clearly straight. How dare you take my straight boys and turn them gay?
Yes.
And then it's like, well, it's written in the subtext. I'm so sorry that you can't see it, but it is. but it's the fandom kind of had to fight against. And a huge reason why the Dramini and Draco or Drarry fandoms hated each other. There was a lot of hate from Dramini who wanted Draco very vehemently to be straight, and a lot of hate coming from Drarry, who was very much like, no, Draco Malfoy is, it's a very much a queer love story. And it's just a mess because two of these people wanted the same thing for the character of Draco that they stood behind, because a lot of them were Draco fans, and wrote the same stories in different fonts, but because the homophobia that existed there just kind of tore the fandom apart.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. Like now I feel like a lot of people use these moralistic arguments like, oh, you can't strip it because it's enemies to lovers. At their core, it really is homophobic. But back yes. then, they didn't hide behind anything. They were just literally like, Draco's not gay. Draco's not gay. Draco's not gay. Like, that's what it was. It was that on repeat. But Draco's not gay.
Draco's not gay. How dare you? Like, you're predatory. Again, it's that anti-behavior. You're predatory yeah. for taking a straight person and making them gay. You're predatory for shipping, for being a woman shipping two boys together.
Yeah. Like the Fujoshi, anti-Fujoshi bullshit.
Yes. All of the rhetoric that is trying to make people feel guilty about enjoying a relationship and dynamic, because whether they relate to it or whether they just purely enjoy it, but doing it at the core because they wanted to make sure that the homophobic or the homosexual stopped, that they were homophobic.
Yep, exactly. So in regards to like the hate towards Drarry, there was nothing, they didn't hide back then. They were just like, we don't like gay ships, period.
Truly. But it was also very interesting because, again, a lot of the, because I think it is important because this was existing at the same time that Wolfstar existed.
Yes.
And Wolfstar didn't get as much blatant homophobia because the point of Drarry and the point of Dramione was the redemption of Draco. And it was, again, that idea of like, if we're going to redeem this character, we cannot redeem him and make him gay. Sort of like aspect of homophobia that was ingrained in it. And also young women themselves inserting themselves into the story, and queer kids inserting themselves into the story.
Yes. Let's talk about that, actually. Here we go. I know we have talked about Rima Dora and Wolfstar a few times. You can go back and find our Marauders episode. We touch on it there. You can go back and find our Order of the Phoenix episode. We touch on it there. But we want to talk just a little bit because we're talking about a shipping episode. We can't have a shipping episode and not mention Wolfstar, you guys. We just can't. So let's talk about this. Yeah, so this was like the okay gay ship. Like, if you wanted to do a gay ship, this was the one where you could be relatively safe and not get a lot of hate, was Wolfstar. And I really feel like the reason that it was okay for Remus to be gay, but it was not okay for Draco to be gay, is because Remus was already like a pathetic, sad little man. And so therefore, it's okay to make him gay. But how dare you make this like strong, independent person who's like really trying their hardest and trying to do their best, aka Draco, gay. But sad man, you can make sad man gay. That's fine.
Yeah, it was also not only sad man, but there was also the allegory that was very poorly done of the AIDS epidemic already existing. So it became, I mean, you read the books, it becomes very obvious that Remus Lupin is a queer man. And in fact, the actor played him that way for years before he was told not to. So like, it's an interesting, that's part, that like exists part of it too, is that not only is it the sad man who's already covered in tragic versus the person who's trying to get out, but it's like, oh, there is no denying that this man is queer because he was written purposefully to be that.
Right. Yep. So you had it became kind of like the flip side of what we see in the Draco fandom. And again, there weren't as many anti-arguments exactly, because people were just straight up just wore their homophobia on their sleeves back then online. So what would happen is the people that were shipping Rima Dora, or the people that were promoting Rima Dora in canon, they were told, oh, you're being homophobic for not shipping Wolfstar, yes. Which again, we've talked about, and we did have I think it was in the Prisoner of Azkaban. Right. Yeah. In Prisoner of Azkaban, we actually have a whole section where we talk about that weird phenomenon in regards to Wolfstar and Rima Dora.
It was this whole, like grasping on to, oh my God, we have a man who is so clearly written to be this way, written to be queer. We are not going to let the TERF have him. We are not, what do you mean that all, because you know, biphobia exists within every community. What do you mean the man that is so clearly written as gay, to be gay with his best friend, is now marrying a woman out of nowhere? There's no way we're going to let that happen. It's not allowed. He's gay. He's gay. He's gay. The fact that he's only marrying her because she can turn into his cousin, which is a terrible theory that I hate exists in the shipping wars. that was the whole part of it. It was like that, like, possessive, vehemently, like, you can't give us this crumb and then take it away. And that just took a completely toxic turn.
It really, really did. For sure. And
death threats existed because of it. It was insane.
This was the biggest shipping war, I would say, is the argument over who Remus should be with. That was the biggest shipping war in the Harry Potter fandom. And it was so many wild twists and turns.
I also feel like it defined an age of shipping.
Yeah.
An online internet shipping for a while, because there was this giant war happening within this fandom that kind of hit all areas of the internet, because at that point it kind of overflowed into fanfiction.com as things transitioned out of independent websites and AO3 started coming around. And of course, social media rose. So Tumblr existed. So you started seeing a lot of antis on Tumblr and started seeing a lot of like shipping wars happening, existing there in your social media space. So many people were just like shell-shocked from this, that the etiquette of shipping changed a little bit after this war. And again, we can talk about that rise of the new generation that didn't exist in fandom during that time, that now are vehemently as aggressive as the ones that were during the Remus Lupin age.
Yes, for sure. For sure. Landon, can you scoot towards your window just a little bit? You're sliding off the frame. There we
go.
A little bit farther. Yes. A little bit farther.
I know.
There we go. You got it. Okay. So, I don't know. But yeah, so like, here's one thing that hasn't changed in all of those eras of fandom that you just mentioned. Biphobia is still super prevalent and very annoying and frustrating in fandom. It hasn't changed at all. No one's allowed to be bi. No characters are allowed to be bi. And how dare you?
What do you mean?
You headcanon a
what
character
do you mean
is
a
bi.
Man? A man can love a woman and a man. What are you talking about? That sexuality is fluid.
Male characters especially are not allowed to be bi at all, ever.
No. And again, that is rooted in that homophobia and then biphobia being its own thing. A part of me understands it. A part of me like sits there and goes, man, it would be really cool if we just had a gay character in Harry Potter who was that. Recognizing that Remus's bi-ness is valid, but knowing that JKR wrote him with a woman, not for the representation of bisexuality, but trying to ignore the queerness of the character in general.
Yep. She did it because find out years later, she is quite bigoted. And as we talked about in our actual JK Rowling episode, we know she's a TERF and we don't have any direct evidence that she's homophobic, but it's pretty common that TERFs are homophobic as well. They just don't talk about it as much. So don't be surprised if in a few years we find out that she has been super homophobic all along.
Yep. And I mean, it's her homophobia is, in my opinion, pretty obvious now, just because she is reluctant and is not active in her support because her support doesn't exist.
Exactly.
But yeah, it is a, it's hard because it's like, man, the merits of both these ships are valid. Good. They're good ships. And I wish that there were more people who accepted them both at the same time.
Yes.
And I think that that's some of the best Remus fan fiction and Remus storytelling that exists within fandom, is to recognize that Remus was deeply in love with Sirius. Sirius betrayed him. Sirius went away for 12 years. Remus finally got closure with that. Then that person that he got closure with died suddenly and he was alone. And then somebody loved him to show that he was worthy and he was not alone. And that's a beautiful story.
It really is.
It doesn't need any drama.
Doesn't. And, but can I throw a wrench in this? Yes. Tiny little shout out to the Small Crack Ship fandom of Fenrir and Remus Lupin. Thank you for existing and giving me an alternative Remus ship that doesn't have drama, mostly because you're so tiny, but also for being like extra problematic. Yeah, there are dozens of us, dozens. but thank you for existing and giving me an alternative Remus storyline that isn't filled with fandom drama. Thank you.
Yes, my favorite kind of fandom is fandom that could be canon, but sometimes I do like to dip my toe into the not, like, could never be canon sort of fandom.
Oh, yeah.
And Remus and Fenrir exist there in the dark depths of my soul, and I love it.
It is so a much. Pure crack ship. It would never ever happen, and I would never ever want it to happen. Pure crack ship, but just I love that it exists, that there are a few things on AO3 with that tag, and that others see the possibilities.
But that's because we are problematic bitches and we own it.
It's true. Okay.
But no, yes, go ahead.
Yeah, we've talked about Remus so many times in so many episodes, so I don't want to spend too much time on that. I would like, let's move forward. Okay, next part. What? Oh my God, it's our sponsor, Audible. What? You can support us if you sign up for Audible. You don't even have to pay anything. You just need to do your 30-day free trial and then you can cancel it. And guess what? We still get supported. And as usual, we have a recommendation. So Landon, what are we recommending today for your Audible trial?
Hold on. I was not prepared.
Oops.
No, you're
we blame
good.
The traffic. We blame sure the traffic.
I blame the traffic. I only have the online version of this. So I have to pull it up via this way. All right. So this is Red, White, and Royal Blue, which I don't know if I have suggested upon this stream before. But it's by Casey McQuestion, and it is your enemies to lovers queer romance. Basically take the hypothetical that the Queen of England had a grandson who was queer, and the President of the United States had a son who was also queer, and they hated each other and then had an incident with a cake and slowly fell in love over the course of a year and a half and changed the world. Love it because there are lots of Harry Potter references, mostly critiques within the book, because both characters are like, fuck them. And also it's just a pure contemporary, lovely romance. And it's one of my favorites.
Oh, wow. You've not recommended this before, so I had no idea what this was. All I knew was the title, of course, that because I had asked for that beforehand. But oh, my God, this is not what I was expecting.
Karen,
my mind is blown. Need this.
I might make you read this.
I might have to
read this one, and then we might have to discuss it.
We might have to. I mean, it sounds gay. It sounds fun. It sounds political. Okay. Like, that's all my favorites.
I'm also going to throw in an extra one here that this is a surprise to Karen. And the reason why is because I meant to throw it in last time, but then I forgot. So this is Carry On by Rainbow Rowell, which is also another amazing book. It is available on Audible. And this book series is actually based off of a fan fiction. Okay, so it's very complicated. There is a book by Rainbow Rowell called Fangirl that alludes to the fact that the main character writes Draco and Harry fan fiction. This is the fan fiction that she writes within that novel. So it is a story within a novel based off of Draco and Harry, another ship. Since we've been talking about the Harry Potter ships, I figured you should read it. That's Carry On by Rainbow Rowell.
So Carry On is literally dreary fanfic, but with the serial number scrubbed off. Like, it's not Draco and Harry, but it is, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And there are wings involved. And that's all I'm going to tell you about it.
Well, dreary fans out there, read Carry On.
Carry
Sounds
on.
Awesome.
Yes. So Red, White, and Royal Blue, and also Carry On.
All right. So there you go. You can start your Audible 30-day free trial with audible.com/interstagewindow. And we get perks for that. So you should definitely do it. If you don't have Audible and you would like to have it, it's a great service. You should use that link when you sign up.
Yes, okay. You should.
Next ship. Oh, another Landon favorite. Landon, we've talked about Jilly a little bit before, again, in our Marauders episode, but let's talk about it again, just briefly for our shipping episode. Landon, tell us about Jilly.
Well, Jilly is kind of the tame version of the enemies to lovers that exists within the fandom. And it's written in to be canon. So you have two people who hate each other, who grow up loving each other and get happily married and then die tragically a year later so that they'll never end up in divorce like our Hermione and Ron. So it really is the happy ending of all of the ships we've talked about so far. It's, of course, James Potter, Lily Evans. And the thing I love about the fandom is that it is... that area of the books is so unexplored. We only have the basic skeleton of it. So we have we know James and Lily dislike each other. We know Lily and Severus Snape are friends. We know there's an incident in fifth year, and we know that James and Lily eventually get married. That's all we know. And so being able to play in the bones of that for a playground is such a unique place in fandom. And it's my favorite place to play.
Jilly is quite magical in that way, right? Because we have, direct memories of Severus Snape's that show that Jilly had a lot of friendship for him and issues with James Potter. And yet, when it comes to Remus's and Sirius's opinion of their relationship, Lily was always crazy about James. So you have this kind of like juxtaposition where I really do imagine them as the Ron and Hermione of their time. Like, Ron and Hermione were never really enemies. They just butted heads quite frequently. And that's what I feel like is most likely happening between James and Lily in canon, is that they are butting heads all the time. Lily wishes James would just grow up. James wishes Lily would take that stick out of her ass, you know, that sort of thing. And then eventually, as they mature, they're able to reach a mutual understanding. And yes. And unfortunately, they die so young that that we never find out if their relationship truly worked out long term.
Which I like to think that it would have, that they trauma bonded enough that they are happily living together. But you never know. Who knows? But it's one of those, I think it's one of the classic baseline ships that most people don't necessarily ship. They don't have to passionately ship, but it just kind of exists and people are perfectly love it. Like very much like Molly and Arthur. Like there just are ships that exist within canon because they're pre-established relationships that people find comfort in. And this is one of them that I feel has because of that playground, has more popularity than the others.
Yes, it's very much a default ship. The only time you really don't see Jilly is if you're reading a Snilly specifically, right? That's the only time that you don't see Jilly featured. Like when you're talking about what ships are going on in the background, Jilly is pretty much always there.
Yes. Especially if you're playing, like you kind of have to be a Jilly shipper if you ship Wolfstar because it exists in the background of all of those things.
Exactly. So if you're reading Wolfstar, ship. Yeah. So if you're reading a lot of Wolfstar, there's a lot of Jilly in the background, you know, and that just is what it is.
And I feel like Hermione fills that purpose too, that if you're reading a lot of the other ships, unless you're reading Hermione, Hermione also exists in the background of a lot of these ships. Yes. And it's that nice comfort background ship.
Mm-hmm. It's like there for you, like a warm blanket.
It is. And it's a wonderful, it's so fun. Again, recognizing I'm biased, but my favorite kind of fandom is the fandom that could seamlessly fit into canon, or just changes a couple of things. And Jilly does that, fits in perfectly.
And it's only got bones, so there's still a lot of freedom in it, even though it's a very canon ship. I mean, obviously Harry Potter doesn't exist without Jilly, But so it's a very canon ship, but because we don't know much about it, there's still lots of room for fandom to play, which is what makes it so appealing if you're looking for a good canon ship.
Yes. And you know, if you ever want to read any, I have a Jilly fanfic that I've published recently. So
where'd you publish it at? Do you want me to put your AO3 in there or something?
Yeah.
AO3. Okay, there we go.
I threw a link in there. Feel fabulous. Free to read it.
Okay, so everybody go give Landon some kudos on AO3.
Please and thank you.
Yes. Okay. So Jilly. Again, we've talked about Jilly a lot in other videos, so you can go find that there. We're going to move forward because we have already discussed Jilly in detail. Here we go. Next is Snilly. Okay. So I know, Landon, you do not like this ship.
But it's important to fandom, and it shapes fandom in an important way.
It is. It's very important to fandom. Snilly is definitely the ship of choice for people that wish for a Snape redemption. As Landon said earlier, it is very common in fandom and very easy in fandom to push redemption through the lens of romance, like redemption through love and, oh, I fell for this person and now I'm going to change my ways and yada yada, right? And I don't want to say that's unrealistic. Like, it's not. That definitely happens in real life. You know, anyone that's maintained friendships over long periods of time and watched their friends grow and change and felt themselves grow and change too knows that, like, this is actually kind of something that really happens, but usually not in the way that fandom has it. So here we come to Snilly, where it really is that ship. It literally is like, I want Snape to actually reach his full potential of being the good person that it's obvious that he wants to be. And Lily is his vehicle for doing that. You know, becoming good sooner is often a trope inside of Snilly fic that we see. Often, if you have somebody that's like, okay, Landon, do you remember the Snape wives? You remember the Snape Wives?
I do remember the Snape Wives, yes.
So the Snape Wives were an online fandom of people that really liked Snape. And I think most people were pretending. And I was like, kind of, I perused this and I posted a few times. Like, I was pretty young, so I wasn't like super active in this. But I was there. Okay. And I think most people were joking. But I think a few were actually serious. But anyway, some of these people.
There was an entire cult. Most were serious.
Well, the people that were super active, right? There was a lot of like activity that was like normal amount of fandom coming and going, right? So that's like where I was on that. But there was quite a few people that were very obsessed with Snape, and they would literally like, they would like see him in their dreams, and they really believed that they were somehow like spiritually married to this fictional character. It was wild. Now, again, I think that most of them were playing pretend, if I'm being honest, but there are probably some that were not. But I will say that within that Snape Wives fandom, Snilly was incredibly popular. And actually, there was drama in the Snape Wives about whether you were truly a for real Snape wife if you thought Snilly was okay, because that means that he was not married to you. Right.
But it was okay that he was married to all these other women around.
It was crazy. Okay. It was crazy. Like, I don't even know like how to explain the logic, because there really wasn't much logic to it. But I will say Snilly was incredibly popular. And the reason why is because it's the one canon thing that is easy to put Snape into. If you want to do anything else, you have to do a little work, right? I think the next most popular Snape ship even is probably Snape and Hermione, which would never fly in today's fandom. Like, people would rage, but, you know, I'm just saying, just like Dromione, there's some stuff out there. Y'all Snape and Hermione shippers have written some real good stuff. I'm just saying. It's good.
I'm going to be honest. I've never read it. Not my thing, but if you like it, I support it.
And Snape and Hermione was like old Harry Potter fandom. Okay. Like, that was one of the ships that you would see during like book one and two's publication before Harry Potter got crazy popular. It was, you know, that was a wild time in the Harry Potter fandom. I'm just saying. But yeah, as far as Snape goes, that's really the only two ships you even ever see, period. Like, there's a little bit of Snape and James, which I fully support. Okay. More Snape and James, please. I'm here for it. But you just don't see it very much. You really don't. Even though, like, imagine the possibilities, guys. Imagine what could be. I'm just saying. Like, just think about it. Just think about it. Just think about it. But yeah, Snilly. So yeah, your thoughts on Snilly Landing. Go ahead.
Here's the deal. I know how Snape grows up. So I know that his redemption is terrible.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't, as much as JKR would like to be like, he's a good guy, he was redeemed. He wasn't. He was a terrible person. So I have a tough time putting him with Lily when I know that even on the best of him is still going to be an abusive asshole to small children. And that's just my thoughts. It is an important cornerstone of fandom because of the love for Snape, but also the shipping wars between Snilly and Jilly.
Yeah.
And what that resulted in the fandom, much smaller than Hermione and Draco and Rima Doris and Tonks, or Rima Doris and Wolfstar, however, still exists. Like, we don't see as much between Rima Doris and Wolfstar anymore. We don't really see much between Draco, Drarry, and Hermione, but there's still a lot of Snilly versus Jilly that exists on different platforms. Like, even TikTok, it exists. And it's interesting to see that this is the war that has continued on a decade later.
Well, you know, I think there's reasons for that, right? Because I think that the Harry Potter fandom, a lot of us are so much older that we kind of don't really want to engage in the same way that, you know, ship wars happen nowadays, like the anti type of stuff that doesn't really happen so much. But I will say in regards to Snilly versus Jilly, that's different than those is Snape is still a very polarizing character. People still have really strong opinions about whether he's a decent guy or not a decent guy. And I think that as adults, it's even still more polarizing because we see him from the perspective of an adult watching how he teaches his class, which basically is not. He doesn't teach like at all. He is totally wasted as a professor in that part of the role. And so when we look at Snilly versus Jilly, I think it still can arouse quite strong feelings because we don't say like, oh, but Draco's like, he's like 15. Like there isn't that. Like Snape is not 15 when he's abusing these kids. He's like 25, right? Or whatever, like 20 something. Maybe it's later. I don't know. I have to go look at the math. But he's older, right? He's older and he's abusing these kids still. And so like it's as an adult, it's hard to look at that and just make excuses for it that makes it easy to enjoy. So I think that people that are thinking a little bit more deeply about what they're consuming and thinking about it from a moral perspective, like it's hard for them to enjoy Snilly, to like take the, to become so, what's the word? Suspension of disbelief. To engage their suspension of disbelief with Snilly in the same way that people can engage their suspension of disbelief with like Drarry or Hermione, right?
And again, yeah, reminding myself that like me and a lot of people in fandom are bi. Like it has a suspension of disbelief sort of ability, and also enjoying fandom that could fit within the narrative that exists. There are some people who love wild UAs, who love ships that wouldn't exist within canon, and then there are some that do and are able to make sense of it. Snilly is automatically not that, because if you had Snilly, you would never have Harry, which means you would never have the Harry Potter series.
Yeah. So it can't exist as anything but a crack ship.
Yes, exactly. And I think that that's not a bad thing by any means. It just is part.
It just is what it is.
Yeah. Just is what it is.
But the Harry Potter fandom would certainly not be the same without Snilly. Like, I couldn't even imagine like what Marauders fandom would be like without people that ship Snilly. Like, I don't even know. Sorry.
Yeah. And I think also like the existence of Snilly is vitally important within the novels too. Yeah. So I appreciate that, like that is a direction that JKR chose to go. And a lot of people saw coming prior to the big reveal that Snape was in love with Lily. Oh, yeah. Because I think it does drive not only the theme of the novels and the series forward, but it really does tie things together nicely. Mm-hmm. So like the birth of this ship makes sense and is awesome and is great and drives the story and the fandom into a good direction. It's just whether you enjoy it or not. And again, nothing wrong with not enjoying it.
True. So yeah, if there's any Snilly shippers out there that watch our stuff, I would love to hear from you, because I feel like this is one of the ships that, although I definitely see it a lot in the fandom, I haven't connected with a lot of people on an individual level. Like I just haven't happened to make a lot of Snilly friends. So if this is you, I would love to know. Please comment down below for the YouTube watchers. If you're watching live on Twitch chat, you can use the Twitch chat. But yeah, I'd love to know. Yes.
Why Snilly?
Well, it's more just like I don't think I have any Snilly friends, which feels really weird to me because there's lots of Snilly people in fandom.
There are. I think I can also see them being quiet. Like this could be a ship that they are quiet about. Mm-hmm. The reason being that a lot of people don't feel safe because of the backlash that they have gotten for being Snilly.
Yeah. I mean, it's probably the same thing as a lot of Remodora fans don't talk about it so much, you know, for the same reason.
Exactly. It's kind of like that beaten into submission sort of thing.
A little bit.
Which sucks to know that like there are still ramifications of that exist within our fandom.
True.
It is nice to see that there can be different sides of like TikTok is where a lot of like, I feel like a lot of cosplayers for the Harry Potter fandom have moved to. Mm. And so there is a lot of Harry Potter content being made there. And Snilly, it does exist on the site. It certainly has come up on my For You page before. Yeah. So it's like, okay, it's nice to know that there is a corner for people who want to find it.
Yeah. And I feel like when it comes to like cosplay content, I feel similar as I do role play content. Like sometimes you just connect with another writer or another cosplayer and you want to portray a ship, even if it's not really your cup of tea normally, but you want to do it with that person because you like that person. Right. Or you like their writing or their cosplay work or whatever. Right. Yes. So yeah, it's a little bit different, I think, when you're talking about it in a cosplay, standpoint, in the same way that it's different when you're talking about it in a role play standpoint. There are ships that I'm not into,
but again,
except in role play.
Yes, absolutely. But again, I think that is showing the transformation of fandom too.
Yes.
Fandom it exists on Tumblr, but not to the extent it did in 2012. It's moved. It's had to move to different social media platforms because that's how it grows.
Yep.
It certainly hasn't faded. And so I feel like cosplay is a huge way that fandom across the board, not just in Harry Potter, but across the board has blown up, especially because there is a transformative piece to it too, that a lot of queer kids are attracted to because they can then cosplay and do sounds and act out scenes to certain trends that they want to in characters that they might feel like represent them, but don't look like them.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. So. All right. So Snillies, tell us where you are. Comment down below. All right.
Where are you hanging?
Now.
Where's your lunch table?
Oh my gosh. Bill and Floor. Okay. This is another canon ship. This is a canon ship I am very, very much into. Okay. I like these characters. I know it's technically a het ship, but I don't know because Bill goes through the werewolf thing and then Fleur's a Vila. I don't know. I really enjoy Bill Fleur when there's like
Bill has such bi wife energy.
Really? He does.
He has such bi wife energy. It just exists.
I just feel like when I am looking at Bill and Fleur stuff, when I'm reading Bill and Fleur stuff, I love if like Bill and or Fleur are like bi, or you add in a third character and they become like a throuple. Or, you know, there's some kind of transness going on, usually in relation to Bill's werewolf stuff. That's usually where that comes up, if there's any kind of like trans-ish allegory. But Bill and Fleur is like, it's amazing. It doesn't get enough love and it's a canon ship, but it's beautiful. Shout out to Bill and Fleur.
it's two background characters who exist. And it certainly marks plot points, but none of them actually directly involve Harry, Ron, and Hermione until the wedding.
Yeah.
And so even though we see a moment of Fleur standing up to Mrs. Weasley in the hospital room and basically saying, I'm good looking enough for the both of us. Harry doesn't care. Hermione doesn't care. Ron doesn't care.
Why would
it just
they?
Kind of exist? It just kind of exists. And so we naturally have that feeling of, as a fandom, it doesn't exist until you really dig into it and you want to find those niche ships that people will write fan fiction about.
But I think that's what makes the ship so fun, is because there's not enough canon on there. So you can kind of make your own version and they all feel equally valid. And they all feel equally oh yeah, I see it. I'm enjoying myself reading this.
Absolutely. And that you can play around with it again, because it has the bones of something and no real detail to it.
Yes, absolutely. So Bill, Fleur, absolutely love it. I think we've talked both about us loving Bill specifically and loving Fleur specifically in various episodes. So I don't think anyone's surprised to see a slide for Bill, Fleur, and a little mention of how good that ship is.
We just needed to put it in there, especially because we're about to get problematic.
Yes. Okay. Do we have anything? I don't really have much to say about Bill, Fleur. I just want to say I love it so much.
No, I mean, I think that was the purpose of us putting it in there, is that we talked a lot about it in the Half-Blood Prince episodes.
Yeah.
As far as the importance of them within the stories narratively. The fandom is sweet and cute, and it exists kind of similar to how Molly and Arthur exist. It just is there on the periphery.
Their background a lot of times. Okay. So let's get problematic, you guys.
You made it this far. I don't know what you were expecting.
I don't know what you were expecting either.
We already talked about Snape Wives.
You're gonna click on a Harry Potter shipping video on Karen Terry's channel. Man, you know it. You know this was gonna happen. You know this was gonna happen. If you didn't know, what are you doing?
What are you doing?
Do you watch my content? I question. Rar, oh no. Okay, so when I was a little baby Harry Potter fan, when it was first coming out, one of the very first ships I came across for Harry Potter was actually the twins. And yes. at that time, I remember thinking, this is the weirdest shit, because I just was so young and I wasn't really thinking about it. And I was these are the characters were kids, so it just wasn't a ship that made sense to me. Like at that time, I was more interested in because they're teenagers in high school essentially, right? So I'm thinking in my child mind, common ship would be some kind of student teacher pairing, or some kind of very obvious pairing between the kids, such as Ron and Hermione, right? And so when I saw that there was a decent fandom for pairing the twins together, I was just huh. I remember being deeply confused and not understanding the appeal at all. And then, later,
you read some.
Well, of course, duh. I mean, I was curious and a teenager, so I read it. And then I never really remember attaching to the ship or being super involved in the fandom or seeking it out. But if it was posted somewhere that I happened to see, I might read through it, right? But then several years later, I watched Ouran High School Host Club. And there is a twins ship in there that is explicit and overt and basically canon. And then I was kind of oh, when I saw the Ouran High School Host Club show, I thought back to the Weasley twins. And it was just kind of this light bulb went off in my head. And I suddenly was I get it. Okay, I get why people ship the twins. I get it now. And not that I was, they weren't my preferred ship of Ouran High School Host Club, but it was suddenly the appeal made sense to me. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? And so for me, even though I'm not super into the Weasley twins, mostly because they're kind of stupid and goofy, you know what twins, siblings I think are actually real freaking cool, some background characters in Harry Potter fandom. Our favorite Death Eaters that barely get any screen time, the Karos. Okay, so I'm real down for that. I'm real down for that. If that's a background ship in your Death Eater fic, like, praise. Thank you.
There are six fan fictions about them on AO3. I read all of them. And it makes me so sad that there are only six, because yes, we have history with that ship, obviously, but it is the best.
Yeah, I usually see them as a background ship in some other, you know, some other like Death Eater featured something. That's typically how I would see the Karo twins.
Yeah. So for me to explain how the twins crossed my page, there are some things that you need to know about me. And that was the series that my ADHD obsession really took a shine to in the sixth grade was Flowers in the Attic. And if you've never read Flowers in the Attic, it is a book series. It is a dark romance book series about four young children who are trapped in the attic of their old grandparents' house by their mother and are forced to like live years up there and basically go through puberty up there. And it's dark and it's fucked up. And why anyone was allowing me to read this in sixth grade, I don't know, but I was, and I loved it. And so like by the time I was exposed to like fan fiction on the like being able to go on the internet and actually read fan fiction, I was reading just everything, and I came across the Weasley twins and I was like, can't be worse than Chris and Kathy, because that's a ship that exists.
Can't be worse than Chris and Kathy. That's such a statement. Okay.
Can't be worse than Chris and Kathy. And so I read it, and it wasn't worse than Chris and Kathy. It was funny and wholesome. And then weirdly, kind of because of how the canon story goes, as far as like Fred dying and then George marrying Fred's girlfriend, I was like, man, there is a world in which this ship is canon. 100%.
Okay, you're right. Like the way that the twins end in canon, it is super weird, right? It's super weird.
It's super weird. And it's just like, okay, I'm like, Joanne, did you mix up your own characters? Or what happened here?
It might just be an honest mistake.
It might be, but man, did the twincest flags fly because of it. And I'm just like, yeah, this is cute. And also, another thing that if you don't know this about me by now, what show are you watching? I am a whore for a tragic story. I am a whore for a tragic story. And if you give me a set of twins and one of those twins die, and there's also some like twincesty sort of things going on in there, I'm gonna love it.
Well, you know what? If he hadn't died, like they would have just like run their joke shop together and probably lived together for forever. Like, let's be real. They would have.
Super codependent.
Super codependent. Like no one else was friends with those twins like they were with each other.
I'm sorry, you didn't think them and Lee Jordan were all hanging out, circle jerking? They were.
I mean, there's definitely some fic. I'm just saying.
There is, and it's great. So here's the deal. Harry Potter is a huge fandom. Mm-hmm. It's a large fandom. And it is full of the best and the worst of problematic ships. And the reality is that part of what makes the fandom beautiful is the opportunity to be able to explore all of the dynamics without judgment.
Yes.
Truly. And I think that that's something that like was important that we wanted to talk about, and why we brought up the twins is because that's the fun of it. There is, because of the purity culture that exists within fandom spaces now, but also within our greater society, there's a lot of push for feeling shame on enjoying problematic things. And it's important to remember that you don't have to, because someone out there probably likes it too. And the most important thing is that you don't bring those problematics into your life, especially if they're unhealthy. And then also that you understand and maybe admit and are able to admit that, hey, this thing might not be the best in real life, but this is fiction and that's okay.
And if you have trouble separating fiction from reality, that's not my business. That's for your, you and your therapist. And I just like to think that Harry Potter is a huge fandom, and it's an old fandom. It's been around for a long time. And I still believe, and most of the Harry Potter fandom does tend to prove this to me because a lot of us are older. There's room in the house for everybody. You know, there's room in the castle for every single type, every single kind, no matter what your interests are. There's a space for you in the Harry Potter fandom. And most fandoms are not big enough and old enough to be able to say that, but the Harry Potter fandom is.
And I appreciate that, because we've been through so many ship wars, because there have been so much pitted against each other, because it's been played on various different websites and social medias, that we now are willing to call ourselves out on it and call each other out on it, that it's no longer tolerated because we're older, because we've been here longer, because there's been more development that exists and continues to grow in some ways, that no one is tolerating, you know, the Rima Dora versus Wolfstar bullshit anymore. Mm-hmm. Even with the Snilly and Jilly, like, sorts of like snaps, that there is always someone sitting there and being like, dude, go like your own thing. Get off the For You page then if you don't like it. Block it. And that is something that I find very rare in fandoms these days. That people are just allowed to enjoy space in the house.
Absolutely. So I think that was the last thing we wanted to touch on. Let me just switch back here so you're not looking at my screen. Okay, you guys. So that was our show today. That's what we wanted to say about Harry Potter ships. We have got for the next couple of weeks some fun stuff planned, so I'll tell you a little bit about it right now. I am moving at the beginning of August. I've talked about this on my Thursday stream in a little bit more detail, but because of that, the first couple of weeks of August, we're not going to have any streams, and we're doing some kind of chill fun stuff for the rest of this month. So our next two episodes are going to be fun tier rankings. So if you want to know our rankings of Harry Potter movies, come next week, we're going to do that. And the week after that, we're going to rank the Harry Potter men and which ones do we think will hold your drink while you go to the bathroom or do something else with your drink. Who knows? But that's what we're going to be doing the next couple episodes of Interstage Window before I move. And then after that, whole new set, baby. We have a whole new set. It's gonna be banging and awesome. I'm really excited for it. Yes.
I feel like, we might have new sets at the same time.
I think we might.
I think we might. We're gonna come back to completely new ESW sets.
Yeah, totally new look. Totally new look.
Backgrounds.
Yes. All right, you guys. Also, next week on Artistic License, we're continuing with doing the Species Conquest. So if you are interested in the Final Fantasy X playthrough I've been doing, you should come back on Thursday as well. So with that being said, Landon, where can everybody find you?
You can find me at Landon Maine on Instagram and Twitter. And you can also find me at I'm a Slytherin on AO3. We'll just throw that in there in case you want to read some of my fanfics. They've been nice and fluffy and tragic. And also lurking in the Discord server. So come say hi and maybe I'll emoji you back, because that's sometimes right. I lurk and sometimes I just don't see it.
Yes. Okay, you guys. So you can find me at all of the usual places. I'm most active on Twitter as far as my social media goes. Also, all of my VODs get posted to YouTube, so you are welcome to go and find old episodes there. I encourage you to do that if you're interested in Harry Potter, especially. I stream on Saturdays and on Thursday evenings. So, yeah. All right, you guys. So we have a very special person that we are going to raid today. So we are going to raid into Ariel Fabulous. We've raided her a couple of times before, and remember, she joined us for Among Us. But the reason that we are raiding her today is because she is doing a 12-hour charity stream. She's doing a 12-hour charity stream. She's playing Breath of the Wild, and the charity is for the National Network of Abortion Funds. So please go and go ahead and take a look at her content. If you have the capacity to donate, I heavily encourage you to donate as well. She's got a fun bingo thing. It's really going to be a cool time. So that's who we're going to raid today. All right. Of course, as always, you guys, then I'll see you later. And don't forget to make it a great day.
Don't forget to be awesome.
All right. Bye, everybody. See you next week.
Bye.